Hello, it is Ryan, and I was on a flight the other day playing one of my favorite social spin slot games on chumbacasino.com. I looked over the person sitting next to me, and you know what they were doing? They were also playing Chumba Casino. Coincidence? I think not. Everybody's loving having fun with it. Chumba Casino is home to hundreds of casino-style games that you can play for free anytime, anywhere, even at 30,000 feet. So sign up now at chumbacasino.com to claim your free welcome bonus. That's chumbacasino.com and live the Chumba life. No purchase necessary. VGW. Void where prohibited by law. See terms and conditions. 18+.
What is happening, everybody? I'm Larry Roberts.
And I'm Sarah Lucy, and this is Brandon, your comprehensive guide to creative branding.
And on this episode of the podcast, we're going to talk about something that's it's hitting a little close to home, because Sarah and I are getting ready to go to a conference, and we're making sure that we have everything that we need in order to represent our brand in our booth properly at this conference.
Yeah, so we are going to be in the expo hall at PodFest, and this is only the second time together that we've done this and that we've had our own booth, and there's a lot more that goes into it than either of us really thought, and it's kind of overwhelming.
Oh, it can easily be overwhelming. And I mean, let's just be honest. I was resistant to even having a booth at PodFest, and I'll put that out there. And the reason for that is because it's so overwhelming. There's so much more to just representing your brand and your business if you're presenting at a conference. It's, man, you know, because I've been to a ton of conferences, and I've had booths that more than sometimes when you're a speaker at a conference, they just give you a booth. And I'm like, oh, thanks, that's sweet. And then I try to represent my brand at that conference where I'm speaking. And well, I've come up short a couple times.
What did you used to do?
I mean, I have two retractable banners. And typically banners come in what? I don't know. They're 3 feet wide or something like that, that retract. And that's what I have now. I have two 3-foot retractable banners. But I think the first time that I did it was, I mean, I went all out. I was like, okay, I got to go cat daddy here. So I went to a local sign company here in town, and I said, look, I need something for an 8x8 booth. And they built me out this massive, it was curved, and it had this like pillowcase type cover on it that had my brand. And it was kind of like a step and repeat banner where you saw my brand repeated multiple times on the banner. And it had all this pipe that you had to put together and a framework. And it was crazy. And so I put that together, but then what else do I have? I didn't really have anything. I didn't have any like information cards or any pamphlets or any brochures. So I had this nice fancy thing behind me, but I didn't have anything on the table.
Oh, how times have changed. So the first time that you and I did this together, there was barely like room on the table for information because we turned our booth into a friendship bracelet making station.
Dude, and who was I talking to? I was literally at a local networking event just yesterday here in Dallas. And I was talking to a fellow podcast production company, and I was telling her about our experience.
Is it Virginia?
It was Virginia. Virginia Elder is her name. And Virginia and I, we both belong to the eWomen's Network here in Dallas, and we had our monthly meeting. So we hung out yesterday, and we were talking about it, and I was telling her, I said, yeah, we have a booth at PodFest, because she's going to be at PodFest also. And I said, but man, I'll tell you, I had to just turn it over to Sarah and let her run with it, because, you know, we did the Spark Christian Media Conference. I don't know, it's been a few months now. And we've talked about it on the podcast. You came up with that idea to have a friendship bracelet making station. And I thought it was the most ridiculous thing I ever heard of in my life. And I was like, this is so dumb. And I'll tell you, it was the most successful booth that I've ever been a part of. And it was successful in the fact that it just had so much engagement, and so many people came to the booth, and not just came to the booth, but they hung out. And we got to know these people. We got to interact with these people. And we got to have these lengthy conversations and really engage and build relationships with the people that came to our table. And that's absolutely critical if you want to also build your brand going forward.
And yeah, that was the first time that I personally planned a booth for an event. Like, I've represented other companies at their booths and they handled everything and I just showed up. They needed a body. But that was my first time. And I remember just like thinking about all of the conferences I've been to and how impersonal every booth was. And they all have the same giveaways. They're all these mass-produced little toys that end up getting thrown out, or you're like, why did I even take this? You thought it was super cool at the moment. Then you're like, oh, I don't even want to put this in my bag. And I just didn't want to be part of that. I'm like, why? It's just so mass-produced. And I just wanted something to be different. And when you're coming up with your idea for your booth and how you can be different, you really want to think about what your brand is and what your brand represents. Because for that one, like our brand was branded, and we talked where our whole idea is to spread like your brand. So with the bracelet, it was instead of giving you something with our brand on it that you're just going to throw out, let's make, let you make something yourself, which means you got to spend time at our booth, but it's with your brand on it. So it kind of went directly into our whole mission of spreading your brand. I didn't expect people to actually pick up on that as much as they did, which was kind of cool.
I think too, it was so cool because we provided value. You know, they literally came to our booth and they walked away with something that they felt was valuable. And a lot of that had to do with the fact that they put themselves into the giveaway, you know, which was the bracelets. So we had people that were coming there and they were making bracelets for their brands, for their podcasts. And what I thought was really the coolest.
Some made them for like their grandkids.
That's where I was going. That was what was so cool, is that like, this is the coolest thing ever. They came back multiple times. And I mean, some people spent a lot of time at our booth making multiple bracelets, and they were giving them to their grandkids and their children. And I just thought that was so amazing to see that, that we were able to provide not only awareness for our brand, but provide something that people found value in. And I think that's what's so different than, like you were alluding to, Sarah, you were talking about the booths that, you know, yeah, you get a foam ball, you know, a stress ball or something, or whatever it may be. It's nowadays you get what? You get a 2 gigabyte memory card or something. You know what I mean? It's just, you just get silly stuff that we end up throwing to the side and we never even use. But I will guarantee you that the ladies that came by our booth and they made those bracelets for their grandkids, guess what?
They've been worn.
They were gifted, and they thought about you, and maybe they even thought about me a little bit too while they were giving those bracelets to their grandchildren. And that just takes your brand value to the next level.
Yeah. So then, well, fast forward to now we're a couple days away from PodFest, and while that was a great idea and we love doing it, I still have plenty. We could do it again easily. But you also have to tailor your booth and your ideas to your audience. We put a lot of thought into what we were going to do for that event based on the audience that was there. But PodFest is a different audience. So we wanted to do something a little more exciting, like a little less sit down and put like make this little bracelet. Like, what can we do that's engaging on a more, like, I don't know, like higher energy kind of way? Because PodFest is far more like of a kind of like a party conference.
Yeah, yeah. The Spark conference for Spark Media is, you know, it's kind of a family feel. It's got a family feel.
It's laid back.
And the demographic is probably 98% female. And so you created that booth that really catered to that particular audience, and you did an amazing job there by doing that. But PodFest, it's probably 50-50, male, female, and the age range is, it's anywhere from 18 to 80. So you've got a wider range of people that you're going to be dealing with, but also at the same time, it's literally a multiple day party. I mean, everybody there is just partying, talking about their podcast, being excited to be around other podcasters. And honestly, this year for PodFest, it's next level. The numbers for the attendees are through the roof for PodFest.
It's the 10th anniversary. It's a big deal.
It's the 10th anniversary, and it's just going to be one big. And I think the theme is a 90s party throughout the entire event. So, you know, you're right. We had to come up with something that was a little more exciting than and that sounds condescending. We had to, just a different perspective.
Yeah.
Than doing vibe. A placement station. Yeah, different vibe. There we go.
Yeah. So are you going to tell them what we're doing or am I?
Oh, go ahead. This again. And here, I want to stress, folks. And this goes back into how you really address your brand and your business at conferences. And that's really what this whole episode is about. And I have not done a good job over the years of representing my business well in a conference environment. Now, I think I do a fine job from the stage and networking and being in the mix. But if I have a booth, yeah, it's just, hey, here's the brand name and here's a business card on a 6 foot long table. There's just not much going on. But Sarah has once again constructed an amazing experience. And I think that's what you need. I think you need an experience for people to really remember you and your booth at an event. So tell us about the experience this year.
I'm excited. So our booth is actually going to be a photo booth. And we have a giant inflatable backdrop that is lights up, and we have all these lights and inflatables and balloons and all of this. It's going to be really colorful, really PodFest. And it ties into our brand because, again, we're trying to give you something that's personal to you and your brand, but the photos that are taken at our booth will have the branded logo. But we recently almost rebranded because we used to have a different tagline and it was building better brands through podcasts. And because our logo is a bunch of stickers, at least that's what it's supposed to look like, we kind of changed that tagline to be more of a pun because me. And
she is the pun queen.
It's building brands that stick. So I have a printer that's going to print out the photos taken at the booth onto little 2x3-inch sticker paper. So you get to make yourself into a sticker from our booth. And it's such a multi-layered pun.
Multi-layered, like the sticker logo.
Like the sticker of our logo. Yes.
I
am so excited purely for the pun that is ingrained in this idea.
See, folks, and you don't talk to Sarah very often, but when I talk to Sarah,
you should. I'm a friend.
I have to weed through. I have to make my way through all the layers and layers of puns that she has laid out there for me.
There's been times where I'll text you a question and I have to follow it up with actual question, not a riddle.
Yeah, 100%. I'm like, how do I answer this? I'm not sure what she. There's going to be a punchline, but no, there's no punchline.
If there's
time.
It's more often a punchline than not. So I actually, instead of like, hey, I have a riddle, it's like, hey, I have an actual question.
Right. Right.
Like that's what I have to specify, which honestly is fine. And you are lucky to be able to enjoy them.
Oh, well, thank you for emphasizing how lucky I am. Sometimes I lose sight of that. Like right now, I forgot how lucky I was to have you as my co-host.
And after this, podcast. The podcast is canceled. So going like with when you think about like the idea that you're going to go with, you also have to think about the little details. And that's where it gets overwhelming. Like coming up with the idea is the fun part. But then it gets overwhelming because you have to put all of the details together. So there are a few things that like we thought of almost like, oh, thank God we thought of this, because if we didn't, we would have been kind of screwed at the time. But for me, the one that stands out is I'm bringing one of those like surge protector power strips.
Yeah.
Because when you get like outlets for your booth, but it's usually just like one or two outlets. And we have a lot of stuff that has to plug in. The backdrop itself has to be plugged in twice, once for the power, once for the lights. We have the iPad for the photo booth that has to be charged. We have the printer that has to be charged. The lights, like everything needs to get plugged in.
We have four different lights that we're using.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, there's so much. And I mean, I think that's a great point that you make there. It's so easy to overlook some of the things that you will need. And, you know, when we were planning the booth, one of the things that we had to do, too, was make sure that the inflatable backdrop that we ended up buying would even fit within the booth.
Yeah.
So typically you have a very confined space, and a lot of times it's 10 by 10 or maybe a 5x5 area where you can set up your booth. And we have a 10 by 10 here at PodFest. So we had to make sure that whatever we're doing stayed within the confines of that space. And that's
we were in Canva critical. Making like a floor plan.
Yeah, we literally did. Yeah,
like
yeah.
To scale, how big is each thing so that we can make sure like that everything is going to fit. There'll be room for people to be walking in and out to take their photos. Like everything we had to plan out or else we were going to get there and we get kicked out because we're taking up three booths.
Right. Like,
we had to pivot. We had a much bigger idea at first, but we're just like, this one might even be a fire code violation. So there was so much that we had to really put that thought into, because if you didn't plan it right, it would not have worked.
Yeah.
We still don't know if it's going to work. We'll find out.
Yeah, we'll have to, we're hoping, you know, and honestly, just this morning I went and I shipped some of our stuff out to be at the event just before we started recording here. And that's something else that you have to take into account. How are you going to get everything that you need to the venue? I mean, we're both in Texas and the event is in Florida. Sarah, I know you've put together an entire suitcase just to lug along everything that we need for the booth. What I shipped this morning was the banners. We have banners as well. So I shipped those off. You're bringing those in a suitcase. There's probably going to be some other things that we have to run to Kinko's or run to FedEx for when we get there. We go,
Oh, yeah. The last conference, we were running over to Office Depot, getting stuff printed. And
yeah, we did that at Sparky, but we sure did.
That's the one.
Yeah, that's so funny. We did because we still, and that's something else that you have to consider. If I remember right, we were printing off flyers with QR codes on them so people could scan the QR code and reach out. That's questions that you have to ask. How are people going to follow up with you? How are you going to capture people's information that comes to your booth? You know, having a booth is great, but now you have to start thinking, this is awesome. I have a ton of people coming here, but how do I leverage this? Because booths aren't free. They're actually very freaking expensive. So how do you overcome the cost of having a booth and get that return on that investment? So that's absolutely critical when you start thinking about the approach that you're going to take to not only capture leads, but then convert those leads into clients.
Yeah. And you definitely want to be thinking, like, I think one of the worst mistakes you can make as far as like a lead generation from these booths is relying on them to reach out to you. When you're an attendee, like for us, our booth is the only booth we have to worry about. This is just that we have one booth and that is it. But attendees, they've got dozens and they're walking through and they're being bombarded with brand messages and sales messages and all of this different stuff. So even though they might say like, okay, I'm interested in every single booth here, they're not going to reach out to every single booth here. And they might not reach out to any. They might just be caught up in the moment, like, oh my God, I love this. Then get home and realize like, oh, I don't need any of this. So make sure that you have it set up so that you are the one in control. You're the one that has that power to reach out to the attendees instead of the other way around. And that's all just goes into how you set up like your lead generation system for the event. So ours is multi-step. We have a few different ones. For the photo booth, we're using an app that to get the photo that you took, you need to give us your email address and then the photo gets emailed to you, or we can print it on the spot or send it to you another way. But we're also doing giveaways. So anytime a booth has those like fishbowl giveaways, that's because they're trying to get your business card. So they have your information. We'll have stuff like that and different like QR codes you can scan to so that we will send you more information. So instead of walking away with a flyer that is going to get lost in your bag or torn or thrown out, we are sending you the information to your email once you're already home and settled and you've like, you're actually taking the time to go through those follow-ups and get back into work.
Well, and I think that's absolutely critical. It's kind of like networking almost, but networking on steroids. How many times do we go to networking events? We get business cards, we get contact information, and we wait for them to contact us. But that's not what you can do with a booth. You have to, if you capture this information and you have their contact information, you got to make sure that you follow up. And that's absolutely critical to getting that initial return on that investment for even buying that booth in the first place. So make sure that you take the time to follow up. Make sure you take the time to organize the leads that you have. And also make sure that you take the time to make that funnel as simple as possible. You want to get your individual's information and you want to make it so that you can follow up very, very easily so that you have an opportunity to make some sales for this thing.
Another point I really want to make is to make sure that you're planning all of this ahead of time, because things have to ship. And like Larry, you just shipped banners out a week in advance to make sure that they get to the event center on time. We ordered, like I said, we kind of rebranded. We got a new tagline and our tagline was on everything. So yeah. I ordered a new table runner to have the correct tagline. And I don't know if y'all live in Texas, but there's been, so there were 3 days straight of like below freezing, and Texas doesn't know how to deal with that. So the shipments are getting delayed. Yeah. And what was supposed to be here on Tuesday with plenty of time to make sure it's correct and get it all packed away, it's not here yet. And I'm getting really worried that it's not going to show up. And we're a branding company that might show up with the wrong branding. So that's a
conversation Sarah and I will have later. We'll talk about that.
You know what? The old tagline is still accurate. It's just old. We still do build better brand new podcasts.
We are not going to go down any path that has to do with being old. We're not going down there at all today.
But at least it's like we didn't change what we do. We're still building brand new podcast. Yeah, it's just I like the one that has the pun.
No, so of course.
Of our collateral might be less punny than I would prefer, because we did not order things as early as we should have.
Well, you know what? Even if they're not punny, the goal is to bring in the money. So as long as we do that, it's all good.
Okay, I do puns. You do random rhymes. We each have our thing.
I'll drop some bars from time to time. God.
And also for your brand, you always have to make sure you're looking fly. Yeah. According to Larry's photo shoot Facebook Live event.
Yeah.
I
caught some heat off of that little live reel that I recorded the other day when I had new headshots taken. But anyways, that's neither here nor there. Hopefully you got some value out of this. Hopefully we've opened your eyes as to what can be done with a booth and some of the things that you got to consider when you do acquire a booth, you know, especially for the first time or two, until you get your feet wet and you understand exactly what goes into having a booth for your brand at a conference. So hopefully we'll see you next week. I think this will drop Tuesday.
So it'll be this week. See you in 2 days.
Yeah, so this will drop on Tuesday. We'll be at PodFest on Thursday. If you're there, man, we would love to say hi, so stop by. But if you found some value in this episode, do us a favor, go ahead and hit that subscribe button so we can bring you this awesome information each and every week here.
And puns.
And some, you know, some bars from time to time.
Yeah.
So with that, I'm Larry Roberts.
And I'm Sarah Losey, and we'll see you at PodFest.
With the Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
This is your captain speaking. We've got clear runway and the weather's fine, but we're just going to circle up here a while and get lucky. No, no, nothing like that. It's just these cash prizes add up quick. So I suggest you sit back, keep your tray table upright, and start getting lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.